Hello everybody, and welcome to part 2 of this multi-equation solver video. If you remember in part 1 of this series, I introduced you to a way of solving equations using a messy procedure that used no symbol manipulation, that was very suitable for computers but not for people. Now we're going to use this to create a computer program that can solve lots of equations quickly and easily, and without any symbol manipulation, like for example this list of equations of motion and this other list of known and unknown variables. The first thing to do is to create a structured type called a variable type. This stores lots of information about a variable, like its name, symbol, value, units, whether or not it has been found, and whether it can be used to find the values of other variables. There are different ways to create structured types, like to actually make them in C++, or to make separate arrays to try to mimic a structured type. Then we'd create an array of them. We'd need 5, corresponding to the 5 variables in our list. And here are the symbols for each. I think I can trust you to fill out the rest. Then we'd have to create another structured type, called an equation type. Here is an example of what can be found in one. A string that displays what the equation looks like as a mathematical expression. The number of variables in it, which is 4. You can count them up to see this for yourself. And whether it can be used. If all of the values have been found, then it can't be used again. And this attribute has to be set to no. And the last attribute is a list of yes and no's that corresponds to whether a particular variable is in the equation or not. For example, the first value on the list corresponds to the variable s and is set to yes because s can be found in the equation. And similarly, the next value in the list corresponds to the variable t and is set to yes because it can be found in the equation as well. But the last value on the list corresponds to v, and since v can't be found in the equation, then it is set to no. And we'd create an array of this equation type, and here are the values of their strings, which can more than describe to us which equations they are. And here is the equation function. In some computer languages, you could include the actual calculation of the function in the function type, but in most computer languages that are primitive and can't perform any symbol manipulation, the calculation of the value of the function must be embedded in the code. As you can see, I've created a function f the way I've done it in the first video. Now we're going to look at the function that determines whether or not a certain variable is in a certain equation, and so fill out these attributes for the equation array. We'll start off with 2 loops. The first one looks at each equation, and the second one looks at each variable to see if it is in this particular equation. We'll look at a single operating point in this equation, setting all the variables equal to 1. We could use more points, but in this example we'll just use the 1. It should be enough for simple equations like linear and quadratic equations. Then we'll set the variable we're checking to equal 0 and find f0 for this variable. Then we'll create a loop and check it for a large number of other values like u is equal to 1 and 2, etc. And find the value of f corresponding to this value of u, which is fk. Notice that we have an additional condition to jump out of this loop. If we find one instance of fk being different, then we can jump out of the loop immediately, which will save time. And when fk is not equal to f0, then we've found an example where this variable u that we're checking for influences the equation and is therefore in this equation. We'll set the variable equal to yes when we've found it, then jump out of the loop. And then in this final line, we'll set the attribute equal to yes or no, depending on whether or not the variable was found to be in the equation. And now to set all the initial conditions. The value of s is known, so we'll set found to yes and set its value. The next two values are also known, like the first one. But these two values are unknown, and we're trying to find them. So we'll set their found attribute to no, and set their value to be equal to 0, for neatness, and to avoid errors in the program. They don't really need to be set to anything yet. And now to start the main loop of this program. We'll loop until not finished is set to no. We'll loop through all of the equations, and if no equations are used, then the main loop is finished, and we'll jump out of the main loop. We can jump out of the second loop after one of the equations is used, and so start again from the beginning of the equation list, hopefully to avoid nonlinear equations at the bottom of it. We'll count all of the unknown variables in this equation, and if there is exactly one unknown variable in it, then we can solve it for this variable. So if we can solve it, we'll firstly find F0, F1, and F2 from it. You can also find other Fs as well, like F3 and F4. So we can reconstruct this equation and find the coefficients of the linear equation from F0 and F1. And we can use F2 to check if it really is linear. And if it is linear, we can solve this equation. And we can also test if this solution is correct. And so, after having solved it and checked the solution, we can move on and change their values. We'll set this variable to have the new value and mark it in as having been found, and also mark off the equation as having been used, so it can be ignored when the program passes by it again. And we can set this Boolean variable to yes, so that we can jump out of the equations loop and start from the beginning of the list of equations, so as to avoid the nonlinear equations at the bottom. And we'll close all the loops with these curly brackets. And we can put in some code to work with quadratic, exponential, and cosine functions. Working with these functions is similar to working with linear functions. I won't put in all the code here so as to not confuse you. Be careful with quadratic functions though, because they can return two solutions or no solutions. And then we'll set the Boolean variable not finished to no, so as to end the main loop, if no equations have been used during the whole cycle. And then you can display all of the results here, using the printing functions in the programming language that you're using. This shouldn't be hard to do. And now for some tips to take notice of in this program. It's a good idea to place non-linear equations at the end of the list. So if a variable can be solved linearly, then it will be, and especially place quadratic equations at the end of the list, because they can produce two solutions. And this program doesn't solve simultaneous equations. It should in theory be able to solve both V and U for these equations if delta V and V av are known. But it won't in this program because neither of these equations will have only one unsolved variable in this case. So an extra equation like this one needs to be added so as to solve for U and V in this case. So I hope that this video has been helpful for you.